yesterday we in fact solved a certain classification problem, but we were unable to formulate the result because we were lacking definition. So my today's lecture will be quite different from the one yesterday. Yesterday we made a lot of great computation, but today we will do more of abstract nonsense type stuff. So I would like to give. So our aim was to get to algebras of Hermite essential operators. So I'll try to define them today. So CDOs, and the main tool will be defining them. We will provide by yet another notion. Those will be analogs of Lie algebra that play the prominent role discussing usual differential operators. So, first of all, I'll start with something really simple. So V is a, it's called a commutative of its algebra. Of course, all part of the negative numbers. Product signs. In any vertex algebra textbook, you'll find at the beginning a statement that a commutative vertex algebra is the same as the usual commutative associative algebra. Derivation. And this derivation then is exactly the part of the structure definition of what itself also carries a derivation. I haven't mentioned it, but we've been dealing with such algebras since the very first talk here. So let me explain this in slightly. So we will be, what we've been dealing with special kind of algebras with derivation, kind of universal such algebras, often referred to as jet algebras. So that, since this is an introductory talk, I'll give the relevant definition. So we have two categories. So algebras with derivation, and just algebra, a commutative associative. And there is a forgetful formula consisting in removing, forgetting about the derivation. The point here is that so this function has the elastic joint denoted like this. So I will remind you, unless you tell me I shouldn't. Do you want me to go over this construction of given ring A? Do you want me to go over the construction of the corresponding jet ring?
Yes.
Okay, so. So the definition of the left adjoint, being left adjoint, means the following. So that's the algebra such that the space of morphisms in the category of algebras with derivation is canonically identified with the space of morphisms in the category of just algebras without derivation. It's a standard fact that if such a thing exists, then it's unique. And whatever the definition, here is an explicit construction that I will be using. Many reasons. industrial construction. I'm sure such objects will be prominent in Tomoyuki's collections. So what is it that we want to do? We are given A, and we want to extend A by adding a derivation in the most universal, in as free as possible a manner. So this is an algebra on generators. You know, like this, A being an arbitrary any element of A. And when I say cell, it's not a set, it's an Abelian group. Then I mean that this symbol is linear. And if it's an algebra, then it's an algebra over a field, and then this is linear with respect to that field. So this goes without saying. On such generators, modulo, just the relations that you can think of. So first of all, of course, A should be there. So this is an algebra with the product and the derivation. So the product will be temporarily denoted by star, and we will identify the new product with the old one. Actually, this should not exact, but the no doubt one, as long as, or rather as soon as these elements are elements from A. S to D, that by the relation. So be applied to the product will give you exactly what you want to give you. This universality condition is easy to verify. So why is this so given an A, then we automatically obtain a vertex cell. Such things will be important. In fact, we've seen them without mentioning much. So, for example, we've discussed.
We already had this example in the very first lecture. That Camille, to get
you did, well, I wasn't here. Okay. That's my fault. So, remember, that was an algebra on as a space. It's a polynomial ring in infinitely many variables. And it contains a subfield consisting, say, of only x's. And there was also defined a derivation, and that was part of the structure. So it's quite easy to see, if you compare that with that definition, that this thing is a vertex of algebra. And it is exactly, its vertex algebra structure, it is exactly the one that you obtain from that construction. The same.
Of course, you didn't say what is the product in this vertex algebra. Yeah. I said it, but you didn't. In the vertex algebra, there are n products also.
I didn't say, but I meant it. You mean there. Minus yeah. 1, of course.
The the tiny differential algebra gives rise to the vertex algebra.
Yes, but. product minus one comes from that algebra, the rest of the products, computation of them is an exercise to the listeners. It should be hard.
And
positive products will all vanish,
I see,
by definition, but negative products, you'll have to think about that.
Yeah, you're right.
Just slightly less less obvious example is when we consider that with A good. When good means that there is an Natal coordinate system. It's the same story. It, by construction, it contains something, and that something of this type. You'll have to think about it. And that will be exactly the jet algebra attached to A. All right, next. That's commutative. So, commutative, but approximating non-commutative correctly, better is provided by vertex Poisson algebras. And this is something that Victor very conveniently discussed today in the morning. So this discussion is related. Here is a statement. So I guess what I'm about to say is a particular case of what Victor and Tomoyuki discussed very briefly after Victor's talk. So what I want to record is the following lemma. So if K is a Poisson algebra, then the jet algebra is naturally vertex Poisson. Such that the structure is not a Poisson algebra structure, but I mean is uniquely determined by postulating that the zeros product. Let me put it this way.
You can write just A lambda B equals to A B.
I'm not good.
You don't like lambda? Okay.
I like with respect for them, but I haven't mastered it enough to put my occupation on the line. So I'd rather do it in the outdated archive manner. So it's the graph. Poisson algebra. So there is a bracket. If here is the condition, if A and B are elements of the algebra. Yeah, of course, the construction of J infinity was such that A lies inside. So if A and B are an A, then the zeros product is the bracket, and all other products are zero. And of course, the product minus one is the old product. I don't know what's the status of this lemma. I've seen it formulated, perhaps even proved in one of Tomoyuki's papers. I think Victor mentioned much more general result, if I got
yeah,
it right.
Yeah, quote in general, is that whatever?
And so probably people could try proving this, at least in this particular case, that he acts as freely as possible, so it makes the computation easier. Anyway, here is the result, and how is it related what I was talking about. Well, we've used vertex algebras. There is a way to go from All right, so the main example. So what's the main example of a Poisson algebra? Of course, the cotangent bundle. Slightly more generally, you take the symmetric algebra generated by derivations. If this ring is, or if this A module is free, then it really is a local model for the symplectic manifold. So this is the simplest example of a Poisson algebra. So we get it once. Work to Poisson. This vertex Poisson algebra, I'll probably mention it right away. It contains, it carries a couple of grading type structures. First of all, it is graded by a conformal weight. The conformal weight here is so the definition of conformal grading is the same as in the vertex algebra, because the structure required is the same. There is a number of remember that was something like this, where does the I operation runs elements from components. So this carries over in vertex Poisson algebra. You may want to think of it independently, but I will soon explain how this algebra appears.
No, but you have to say what is conformal weight of generate.
Yeah, of course, yes. I mean, I simply don't want to say.
But you didn't say.
I don't want to spend that time on that. You will soon see this as a consequence of things that we discussed in great detail. Or you, while I'm talking all this nonsense, you can think about it and find what
I suppose conformal weight of elements from A is 1.
Yeah, of course, function that, 0, that's what you can do it. All right, so another thing, it has another grading.
Ah, A has conformal weight 0.
Yes.
Ah, okay.
So it has another grading, which will also be important. This grading is as follows. It's similar to the conformal weight grading in that elements of A are, as well as all their derivatives, are all have degree zero. But all are, so to say, vector fields, as well as their derivatives.
Ah, but this is not conformal weight because derivative increases.
Yeah, you will see, yeah, of course. That has degree one, independent of K. So this grading simply counts as the number of vector fields. And this is technically not what we would call a grading of an algebra, in that this grading has, I should perhaps introduce notation for this. So usually I would put conformal grading denoted by a subindex, and this grading in this particular case will be denoted by using, say, a superindex. So if for simplicity I denote the whole thing by V, and then you will see that Vn, J, Vm, always lands in Vn plus m minus 1. For example, a bracket of two vector fields, this is an expression of degree 2, which equals one vector field. And that's an expression of degree 1. And this is true for any element of this. lot of personnel, right?
Because J product of functions is zero.
Yes, and that works. Zero, one, zero. There is nothing surprising here. It's perhaps a well-known thing in this guide. And the reason this grading occurs is fundamental. So, Victor explained today how one gets a vertex Poisson algebra as a semi classical, so to say, limit of a vertex algebra using, if I can say so, deformation quantization. So in the case when the operations depend on a parameter, and mention that there is an alternative way, and very similar, to look upon it via filtrations. And he left the task of discussing this to Tomaliki, but that would be kind enough to do it now, because I will need. So, vertex Poisson as the graded versions of filtered vertex. So, the setup here is, again, absolutely standard in the usual algebra. For example, that is like people go from differential operators to functions on the cotangent bundle. And the same works here and will be used, of course, in an obvious way to Chiral differential operator. But the general setup is this. So suppose F is a vertex algebra, and suppose it's filtered. So that the positive numbered multiplications, well, so it agrees with filtration, agrees with products in the obvious way in general. And that perhaps is the definition of a filtered vertex algebra, at least an obvious version of such.
For all J.
For all J. But for positive, no, negative number in J, this thing kind of falls through. So then, of course, one naturally considers the graded space, the direct sum of successive quotients. Of course, F minus 1 and the rest of them are assumed to be zero. So this is a commutative vertex algebra. Automatically. Because if you look at the positive operations, they all land in the denominator. This is an obvious observation. Slightly less obvious observation is that if you work a little harder with all of this, you get a vertex Poisson algebra. Again, this is done in exactly the same way. One passes in a similar situation from filtered associated algebra to commutative associated algebra.
So it's coming to get its algebra, and you can endow it with
yes, yes.
This
endow Poisson, it, exactly. Poisson. So let's endow it. Endow it with its commutative. With a vertex Poisson algebra structure. That's standard. So what you do is you pick classes of elements in from and then you define the non-negative number products by picking representatives, doing the respective products, and then so this is regarded as a linear element of B plus Q of B. The operation is, well, on general ground is there, but if M is non-negative, then it actually is P plus Q minus 1. So you take this modulo the next. So you may have guessed what the main example of this is. Take this ring, or more general again, this can as well be A in the presence of the planetary. That coordinate system. So this thing is filtered. You see, this is a polynomial ring in branches of axes and dels. So we will simply be considering the filtration by the degree of this element there, regarded as a polynomial in depth. So we will define f p. This thing to be
just say what are the degrees of general?
Hmm?
Yes, what are degrees of general?
Then it's kind of misleading because that gives you a gradation.
No, degree less or
well, yeah, of course, it's the same thing, but this is not canonical. What I'm saying is completely canonical.
Okay.
But otherwise, of course, it's the span of polynomials of degree at most in the genes. And then if you remember the definition of the vertex algebra structure, it's like vector fields.
And the degree zero of n functions. Functions can be
yes, of course.
Degree
zero, that will be just functions. You see, it's what I know, that contains this as a particular case. Polynomial of degree zero in terms of delta consists only of x as or in general a's and x minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. And so you, so it's, it of course is a fluctuation, and the graded object is commutative. And in fact, rocket fossil, it's immediate, just as I said, bracket of D and F. So under the bracket, one of the D's, at least one D, goes away, and therefore the this degree falls through, and you can play all this game. In fact, if I'm allowed to ask a silly question, what do you think this is? As a vertex Poisson algebra, it's a question not to Victor or intermediate. It's almost on the board. I have raised it, but we've seen it. Oh, come on! The classical limit of usual differential operators is what? Functions on the cotangent bundle. And that's a vertex algebra, so it should be jets. In fact, I'm not sure Victor would agree, or to Nayuki, but it's really this discussion of going from vertex to vertex Poisson as a result of going from rings to jets is fundamental. It is my impression that this whole business of vertex mathematics really is, so the algebra in the usual sense has it's a vertex conformal algebra is exactly the jet version. Vertex Poisson is the jet version of the, so the right notion of a Poisson algebra on the space of jets is vertex Poisson. That's what I wanted to say. And there is a fundamental reason for that. I don't have time to talk about it, of course, but this is an example of something quite, I think, fundamental. All right, but why am I spending time on this?
Of course, the cotangent bundles given the usual structure for Poisson algebra.
Yes, yes.
P bracket Q equals 1.
I think Tomoyuki will be explaining, roughly speaking, that if you regard a classical W algebra as a Poisson algebra of functions on a Poisson manifold, then corresponding vertex Poisson will be something like this on the corresponding space of jets, right? All right, so why am I doing all of this? Because I can now tell you how one can define an algebra of Carroll differential algebra. So, suppose A is a ring, and definition. A, let me sort of, all right, A, C, O, over A, I mean an algebra of Carroll differential operators over A is a vertex algebra such that first it is graded by conformal weight. Second of all.
But probably you should say what is it is this conformal.
Well, it should be a conformally graded. Some. Okay, I put it badly. But yeah, I wanted to say that this is a conformally graded.
You don't specify.
No, it should satisfy, it should carry some structures. It's a vertex algebra, it should carry conformal weight, it should be filtered as a vertex algebra. And filtration must respect the conformal grade. What I mean by this is that simply each homogeneous fixed conformal, each fixed conformal weight components and intersections of filtered subspaces with each conformal fixed conformal weight component gives you a filtration of the corresponding conformal weight component.
So the filtration induced is a gradient.
Yes. No, this is not a filtration. Say it again.
So this is some additional data.
This is an additional.
As it is,
I'm simply mimicking the situation with the familiar Vicari octave.
So each subspace of this filtration is a direct sum of the.
Yes. Exactly.
What do you call filtered vertex algebra? This property which...
This and this. So, I guess it should be a third condition. The corresponding graded object is commutative. Then, the graded object is canonically conformally graded vertex Poisson algebra. So here is the main condition. 4. So graded. I should have is a vertex algebra. It slightly contradicts what but previously this was always when A is a good. Now it's an arbitrary such that the graded Mikhail A is isomorphic to Jets as TA as vertex Poisson.
Maybe I should add that, in order to make it compatible with my lecture, what Fedya calls VP, I was calling VPA. VPA.
Poisson VPA?
The other order.
Like
this? No, I was PVA. Poisson
VPA. Ah! Poisson VPA.
But many people call it vertex Poisson. Like Edik, I think, calls it vertex Poisson. Anyway, the word vertex is absolutely ridiculous.
Mm-hmm. All right, so now the problem of finding algebras called differential operators has been put into a framework of quantization. So this is something absolutely standard. So we would like to quantize it. Quantize, not in the deformation quantization sense. Maybe it's also a natural question, slightly different from what I asked, but quantizing this filtration.
But it is actually a special case.
Yeah, of course, it's a special case of deformation quantization. All right, this is a non-trivial problem, and its solution is really the topic of these lectures. So. The advantage of this definition is it is very elementary and transparent. I spent some time preparing all of this, but it's absolutely standard. Maybe this algebra wasn't people weren't so interested in it, but otherwise everything I told you is absolutely straightforward. But if we really want to solve a problem, given that, find an algebra so that all of this is satisfied. And when you give this a thought, you would realize immediately that this definition is somewhat misleading. Remember what was the train of thought when we discussed the case of the projective line. We don't need the whole thing. Everything is generated, and that follows from the definition, by the way. Everything is generated by functions and vector fields. Vector fields are, of course, to be taken with the train of thought as we've seen. So we really need to focus on a small part and then use locality or something like this, in order to extension theorem or something like this, in order to generate the whole thing. So technically, in the finite dimension situation, when we're talking about differential operators, we needed for that order one differential operators, vector fields and functions. Here we would like to do the same thing. So hence a more convenient for what follows notion of a vertex algebraic. I think I already told you, so this is an exposition of our work with Gorbunov and Chapman, and that's the notion that was proposed there. What I will try to explain will be slightly different. I think it's slightly. Conceptually much different, slightly different, but I think it makes more sense. This is a result of my reading of the Bailenson Rinchel book that really is trying to mimic their definition.
Did you already introduce the vertex algebra?
No.
Is it previous yet?
Not really. I may have mentioned that this is going to be vertex algebra in general, but no, I didn't.
Okay.
Not quite. At least, well, you will see the difference between what I'm about to define now and what I discussed last time. Mm-hmm. What I discussed last time is indeed what we call the vertex algebraic in this particular one. No, what we call the vertex algebraic. But the actual definition is more pleasing if you do it in a slightly different setup. That's what I'm trying to say. So before I give the definition, here is what I suggest you keep in mind. Again, to return to this model example of beta gamma system. So this notion generalizes.
No, I suppose vertex algebraic is just zero plus first part of the chiral. It's not the whole chiral.
Let me write and you will see. So as a space, it's an algebra on axis, del. I produce the gradient by either rotation. You can consider, as Victor suggested, gradient by the number of the dels. And consider the component of degree at most one. Then it will, of course, contain the component of degree zero, and that's just polynomials in axis, and the quotient, the component of degree exactly one. So that's a free but infinitely generated module of polynomials in axis. There is a suppose dimension is one, but of course there is an upper index. And then the other. Last time I focused on the situation on axis. Last time I focused on the degree conformal weight zero component of this thing, which is fundamental. All interesting thing lives there, but it's more convenient to allow derivation. That's all I'm trying to say. So it is this thing in general that I would like to call a vertex algebraic. So what is it that we have here in this particular case? As we discussed, this is a commutative vertex algebra, the jet algebra. So in general, we will have jets of some in some way. What's this in general? This is also quite clear. We have this vertex Poisson algebra. It's graded exactly in this way. It's the gradient that comes from the canonical filtration. So this algebra is graded, but it's counting the number of vector fields, and we focus on the component of weight exactly one, like we did here. So by definition, a vertex algebraic is a, an A vertex algebraic is an exact sequence.
You mean less or equal to that? One less or equal to
no, no, exactly one. Less than one is all here. This is exactly one. You see? Exactly one D is that.
Ah.
So now I have to complete this definition by pointing out the structure that these three things possess, should possess, and saying that the arrows must respect those structures. So this is a commutative vertex algebra. Let's talk about this thing. It's a part of the vertex Poisson vertex algebra, right? This concrete component is closed under the all positive operations. So this is then weak conformal, right? This is also a module over that vertex. J infinity A module. But Victor reminded you what a module over a vertex algebra is. And this is a rather special module over a J infinity algebra. You see, it's somewhat twisted at the beginning. I found it confusing. Algebra is commutative if all positive multiplications are zero. It doesn't mean that the positive multiplications on the module must be zero. But they are in this case. So it's a J infinity module such that the properties of this you can all derive. I'm just listing those that are important, such that the action of A by means of a positive product equals zero and greater than or equal to zero. It's because a function for this to act non-trivial, it must hit a vector field. And so it goes down.
No, wait a minute. In a module of a vertex algebra, nth product goes to nth product of fields.
That's what
so, so if nth product is zero, then it goes to zero nth product
no.
of the corresponding.
No, that's what I said. No, it's not, for example, here, it's not like that. X minus n is zero, if I understood it correctly. X minus m is zero, of course, for any n and m. Here, for example, x is 0, if you don't need 0, 0.
Ah, are you saying that
is minus 1.
Yeah, I understood what you're saying. You're saying that if you take A, then the corresponding operator A and M on the module is not necessarily 0 yes. for n positive.
Yeah, that's what I meant. That's what I should have. Yeah, I know. If it's,
right.
you have an algebra in the module, then element here has products right. here, the corresponding operations there should right. be called something like this. Right. It's just that I didn't want to write this whole
but
thing
not
upstairs. That's what I meant.
Actually, it's already Borchers in his first paper pointed out.
Yeah, yeah. The Borchers paper is quite remarkable. I know there are many sentences that took people years to figure out and then write volumes. I explain. There are other properties. So the brackets here, so to say, positive operation, this is all part of the weak conformal algebra structure, but you can also see how this interacts with the module structure. But this is all part of the Poisson, a vertex Poisson algebra structure on this algebra. How about this one? So this will be axiomatization of what we see here. So this is a, again, J infinity module. But already in this example, this property fails. And a Leighton formula. And the arrows must, is there anything else? Yes, so I should impose the condition how the Leighton formal algebra operations interact with J infinity A module. It's some kind of a quantum condition, so you will see something like this. So if you take an element of there, that's the bracket of the nth element. Let me call this map and see. So bracket of this with an element in A, or it's A minus M, must be given by the formula that should be familiar to you from the discussion last time. It's that we postulate that this is an axiom. I'm not proving it, but remember, we think of this being generated by, so to say, vector fields, and vector fields interact with functions as vector fields should by the Lie derivative. So you just start writing the Borchert commutator formula, and the only thing that will be non-trivial is the zeroth operation. And that will be like this. I will take, apply sigma to L. That will land me there, and then I will do
so it's different. N and N.
I'm just saying that this is all standard. This is fixed once and for all.
No,
this is
fixed. Related to N. To N. So you have N and minus N, or N and minus M.
Yeah, I'm just thinking of N positive, and this also says N minus L minus J, right? And then there will be the standard diffusion N, J, and sum over J. And so the content of this simply is that this is null. This computation happens inside vector fields. So perhaps I should have simply written this formula for M equals 1, and then it will be familiar. L N A minus 1 is simply given by the Lie derivative. That's a vector field. And you evaluate it on A, and A operation minus 1. And the rest, I guess, will simply follow. So I'm just saying that this is a fix. There is no room for maneuver there. You just get some vector field, and then you compute using formulas, familiar formulas there. That's all. That will give you a function, that's how the bracket works. So that's the definition. Of course, it agrees with this.
So it's a exact sequence of these things viewed as the Lie formal algebras and as modules of the J infinity.
Yes, and all arrows respect the two structures. That
and there is compatibility.
And that of J infinity.
Compatibility.
Yeah. So if you remember my perhaps somewhat chaotic discussion last time when I was moving in the opposite direction, like a physicist, I was just computing what is it that I have if something is given to me. And I was simply working with this, with the conformal weight as one component of this whole thing. And what remained was simply that sum with n necessarily 1, and this, well, that's different. So this should be 1, and this should be 0. This will be only usual function, that's 0, and that's some finite extension, where the main thing unfolds. All right, so that's the main definition. Borgonov-Shachtman method work, the vertex algebraoid was defined to be exactly the conformal weight zero component of this, but then definition becomes a nightmare. Because you just state that these things can be explained in sentences without writing formulas, essentially. Weak conformal algebra, G infinity A modulo, things like that. If you cut away the conformal weights minus 2, 3, 4, etc., what you have to do is you have to write down all identities that are mentioned here that make sense on that small space. You will see that operation 0, 1, 2 makes sense, that's all right, but then there is D that is only partially defined, and there is this identity. Also only partially defined, but A and B are functions, and then is at most one, and things like that. So the result is a list of 7, 8 axioms. They all have an obvious source, but I think this simply is more prevalent. But the actual computations all happen where we were living last time. All right, let's make a break, and then I'll move on.
No, that is not on that.
So what then the relation of these algebraics to a vertex algebra just defined? Well, it's an object of a different nature, it's more of a realgebra. So, and the relation is then easy to guess. It's exactly a vertex version of the relation we discovered between vertex, Lie algebraoids and algebras of differential operators. You start with the Lie algebraoid and define in a specific manner its universal enveloping algebra. It's not quite a Lie algebra, so the definition is slightly changed, but essentially it's like a passage from a Lie algebra to the universal enveloping. So let me make this side. So L sub A gives rise to L sub chiral differential operator by means of some kind of a vertex universal enveloping algebra construction. The construction, in fact, will be very similar to what Victor explained in the case of almost what he explained in the case of Lie conformal algebras, perhaps Lie algebras of formal distributions.
Yeah, it is the same, basically.
It's almost except that here I have an extra structure. Multiplication minus 1, which is not there, so it has to be dealt with. It's just, there is a difference between the universal enveloping of a Lie algebra and the universal enveloping of a Lie algebraoid. Lie algebraoid is a name module that you have to take care of multiplication by function. Otherwise, it's the same, so let me quickly do that. So, first of all, LA is a, apart from other things, it's a Lie conformal algebra. So then, attached to it is the Lie algebra. Let me call it, you know, the places. Defined as follows, it's a standard thing, it's in the textbook. It's a linear span of symbols like this, I'll put brackets like that to distinguish between this and this, of such symbols which are supposed to be linear in X. X is an element of my have, and such that dx m is exactly what you would expect it to be, minus mx to correct. It's a standard fact that this is a real algebra.
Begin to break it. It's a space of the graph.
Yeah, but it carries a canonical bracket given by the formula, so. And then the space, so if you take the universal envelope of this algebra and quotient by the left ideal generated by an appropriate part of it consisting of all generated by such elements with positive coefficients. Then this is a vertex algebra. This is more or less, if not precisely, what Victor explained two lectures ago.
But you said there is something wrong.
But it's not yet.
It's not,
so. That's a straightforward analog of vertex analog of the universal enveloping algebra construction. I need a vertex analog of the universal enveloping of a Lie algebraic construction. So you can easily see the difference. You see, this doesn't. I have erased. I always erase what I try to keep exactly when I finally need it. So. There is a clash of notation. Of course, this thing carries a multiplication minus 1. For example, there are functions there and vector fields. For example, there is this element in that algebra. But there is also element like that, even simpler, just at the level of functions. You take one function and another. But of course, this function was there all along. And we have to identify them. So I suggest that you think of the definition of the usual differential operators over polynomials as the universal kind of a universal enveloping of the algebra of derivations. It's a similar thing. It's a Lie algebra, but it contains x, say, d. However, if you're or this. So you start multiplying them, and that's, you have x v, and you have also x times v. They should be identified. So it's not just a V algebra, it's also an X module. And doing that, we created things that shouldn't be there. They should be identified with things that have already been there. Or perhaps even more importantly, there is an element, a unit here. But a unit is also inside, there is a unit inside CLX. So they should be identified by the very meaning of it. And so we take this vertex algebra, and we observe that elements of the indicated form are what they call singular vectors. So for example, you can take elements like this, or elements, and even like this, or elements like this from size vector field. All these are, as we sometimes say, the singular vectors. And what I really mean is that such vectors, such elements, are killed by the minus. For the reason that the commutations relations are the same. So if you start commuting with things with a positive index, there is no difference between these multiplications. Applying it there and there will give you literally elements of the same kind. And so this allows...
So they're not really thinking of it, they generate an idea.
Yes, that's what I meant.
So, but they're not...
You're saying they're not quite killed.
Yeah,
you're right. So they generate an ideal. Yeah, they're not quite. All right. See, we're back to taking with a grain of salt. So they generate not Q, not Q. So generate
a vertex algebra.
A vertex algebra. Call it, I don't know, temporarily I. And we finally define U. I'll put sub A, indicating that this is not quite the universal envelope in this version in the presence of a ring. U sub A of L. Not too many A's. Probably not such a good notation. But anyway, is defined to be this algebra. Mod out this A. People want to think about it. The suggestion is compare it with the passage from the algebraic to the algebra of distant potential operators, also defined as entirely universal envelope. So anyway, by definition, an algebra of A CDO is a vertex algebra isomorphic to thus defined U sub A L A for some L A. It's easy to see that this definition...
And what was LA? We come from algebra with some...
The vertex algebra.
Ah,
LA was something that
LA
fits between contains this and projects into the degree one component. Oh, it's actually, the notation simply doesn't make sense, and so all that I have to write the whole thing. Like this. So that's what. It's easy to see that this definition is equivalent to the simple one I started with. Here is a remnant of it. If you go over it, you will see that this simply provides an insight into what an algebra is, provided it has a filtration like that. So in conformal weight 1, the filtration will be automatically of length 2, and will give you exactly what we discussed last time. Functions, something, and then vector. Alright, so fine. So here is then the definition, and armed with this definition, I will now tell you what is it that we proved last time. Because it's not an algebra, it's an algebra. I haven't quite proved that, but I proved it like 98%. Remember what we did. We assumed that we have this. We only at that time worked with conformal degree 1, where what I discussed looks like this. This space, as I said, it's part of the whole picture. It is closed under part of the structure. In particular, it closed under all the conformal algebra structure, and we verified for this space all the necessary bracket identities. The complicated one was one when all I and j was zero. The formula is easy to write, but the reason it holds was rather involved. Other identities, when one of them is one, and both are equal to one, the result is zero, obviously. So the remaining two cases are absolutely obvious. I'm claiming that, at this point, could I say that we've got a Lie conformal algebra? No, because the space, unfortunately, is not closed under the derivation. The derivation was only partially defined. But if you think about it, now we've got a bigger space where differential is extended as free as it could possibly be. An easy thing to do is to work in the case, and that's the only thing that really is needed. These two are free modules, and dx on the rest, and of course it immediately allows you unambiguously to extend the bracket and verify over there. So I'm claiming that this is easy, and that's practically the proof. Next, similarly, we discussed how one such thing can be mapped into another. By definition, since we are dealing with A, with all the classical data like this, fixed, any morphism is a is an isomorphism, automatically. It's even so at this level. And that's where it's generated by, you know, by this universal underlocking thing, so it's easy to see again. Well, at the you don't need it. At the level of vertex algebra, you don't need it. The fact that this is an isomorphism at this level, of course, immediately tells you that this is going to be an isomorphism for the bigger thing, again, because we have failure. And we computed that morphisms are given by two forms, such that their co-boundary is the distance. Again, I verified that, or almost verified that was given by Maxwell the best. And I verified that such a map preserves operations on this level, but again, by the way this thing extended elsewhere, it's immediate to see that the verification of that this respects operations like this at this level immediately implies that all the other operations will also be respected. It's absolutely straightforward. And this is practically what we need, except there is one last observation and crucial. Furthermore, you will observe that I haven't said that given an A, there is at least one such thing. I assume that it exists. If it is, if there is an A, that is there. You will later on see that the existence question is complicated. And
you mean given A?
Given A. Is there at least one such thing?
L-A.
Perhaps not. But furthermore, if A is good, has an entire coordinate system, then let me introduce the notation. So let word edge sub A be the category of vertex A algebra. So if A is good, then this category is non-empty. This we also know. An example is provided by, that's what I previously denoted like this, when A is good. I pretended that there is some kind of a canonical example. It's not canonical, but if there is, so if you have a basis, you simply set the...
So on any algebraic variety, there is a neighborhood of any
neighborhood
point.
Yes, it exists. So the construction was, I mean, this thing could be, was described perhaps differently, but the essence of it was simply that we have a function and we have an abelian basis of the space of vectors, and we simply set the, I don't know, that's how, you know, perhaps. So if you take any such, then we simply define product number one among them to be zero. And then the rest is reconstructed canonically. That's what I meant. So this is an algebra that I meant by writing it, denoting like this previously. What I'm saying is, furthermore, not only it's non-empty. Let me denote it. Arrow start. We have one. I'm saying that any LA for a good is automatically this LA starting plus alpha for some alpha.
But I suppose if you take sufficiently small neighborhoods, then omega 2 is 0. Ah. Then.
No.
H2 is not.
The run can be.
Ah.
In principle, complicated. You can't, it's not an
analytic
situation. But here is what I'm saying. All this discussion last time was made under the assumption that all operations are fixed. What you really have to fix if you have an abelian basis is this operation. What I want to say now is that in any LA, you can vary these elements so as to assume that the first operation between them is zero. Why is that?
You mean not zero, but delta I zero.
Di, dxi, this, dxi 1, dxj is zero.
For all I zero.
Yes. You can always achieve that by changing the splitting. Indeed. If the xi1 indeed, well, whatever else it is, it's some function. So, I don't know, g, a kind of a metric, isn't it? So, that's a rule that a pair of tangent vectors assigns a function. So, it's a metric. You get a metric. That's the informal grading simply says that the first multiplication number one between two delts is a function. And so, of course, then, to achieve that this be zero, you introduce dxi tilde. You can always change splitting. And that's the difference between vertex operators and usual differential operators. The derivations can be split out, but not in this case. So you have to do either plus or minus, or one or one half. I'm not sure, but what you do is you take this and subtract, I think, one half of dij xi minus 1. What I simply mean, algebra geometrically, is I have this matrix, so that gives me a metric, as I said, and I take my vector field and evaluate metric on this. Wait, and I evaluate this metric on this vector field. It's just that in my situation, this differential is, I plug the I, so it should be the case. So, no, that's not what I wanted to say. I want to say that I will redefine.
It's a summation over J, right?
Yes, and I'm using the being a physicist and the Einstein's notation. And this will immediately tell you that the new vector fields satisfy the desired condition.
You mean dxi 1,
yes, 1.
No, in the left-hand side, of the question about DXI, just DXI, is that?
Well, I mean, yeah, of course, perhaps like this.
Minus one.
That's what I mean, of course, as always. And that's the vector. So I believe it should be minus and it should be 1/2. The effect of this, of course, is that there is a new splitting, and so the zeroth operation will be changed. But that the change in the zeroth operation is something that we have a good control over. This is governed by those three forms. So you have one example, you immediately rearranging your algebra, get an example where the bracket between basic vector fields, so operation number one between basic fields is zero, and so that immediately proves what I said, that any vertex A algebraic can be written in this form for some fixed. Okay. All right. In fact, in view of my description of morphisms, we have even more. The corollary of this discussion is as follows. So, if A is good, having fixed 1 vertex algebraic, we obtain a functor. Let me talk about functors in a few minutes. We obtain a root to any closed free form we attach a vertex algebra obtained by shifting the initial one.
It's only the 3 or the 2?
Only the 3, unless I made a mistake. Only the 3. Objects are labeled by closed 3 forms, morphisms by specific 2 forms. And any vertex A algebraic is equivalent to an algebraic like this. This is a rather typical these days, an important structure. In order to intelligently talk about it, let me introduce some terminology. So I will use some categorical language. I'll do it light-mindedly. I will skip most of the definition because the essence will be quite transparent. And the language is very convenient. You see, I want to say that having a three form is the same as having a vertex algebraic. It's not quite so, because given a single vertex algebraic, for example, it has plenty, perhaps, automorphisms. What's an automorphism of a form, for example? So in order to talk about such things, you have to use some kind of categorical language, which is just will be done more or less for fun and convenience. So here is what I want to say. I have already introduced the category of vertex A algebraic. That's my one character. Vertex algebraic A. I will now introduce even an extremely simple category. That's the notation. It's objects.
It's omega.
Omega, we just 2, 3. And two different brackets. Its objects are just closed three forms. So objects are the set of all closed three forms. So I could have simply written like this. That's the set of objects. I think of this object set as a category because I will now introduce non-trivial morphisms. So I will say that morphisms from one to another is, of course you can guess, that's exactly what has appeared several times. I will simply formulate this. That's the set of all two forms such that the round differential is the difference . So, as Victor said, I want to think of this as a torsor. So, anything is obtained, you know what usually a torsor is? It's a set with an action of a group, so that for any two elements, there is only one element of the group that moves one from another. So, for example, a group is a torsor over itself. It's a special torsor because there is a distinguished element, the unit. In general, the group of translation acts on an arbitrary line, not necessarily the line that coincides with your group. So, that's a torsor. So we want to think of this category now as a torsor. So our group will be also a category, and in fact, here it is. So I want to say that this category is a torsor over this group, except that that will be a group in categories. So this thing is an abelian group in categories. And what do I mean by that? But of course, simply that you can add elements. There is a functor. I can say a map, although it will look like a map. Better called a functor. So there is a functor, bifunctor. So it has two arguments. But this could have been the sum of two forms. You don't need category structure to define the sum of two forms, it's just a sum. But this agrees with morphisms, that's why I have to call it like this. So it's a functor in that this rule agrees with morphisms. If you have morphisms from alpha 1 to alpha 1 prime, then this morphism, which consists in d beta that measures the difference, will give you a morphism of the sum. So it's quite obvious. Why talk about it? Because this formula now gets a nice meaning that the category of vertex algebraids is a torsor over this group. At least the group acts. So my group. So-called, alleged group.
It's not really a group, it's a category.
Category.
So category acts as a torsor.
Yes. Category acts on this category. By the formula described above. So this is true no matter what A is. Except that if A is bad, then the category can be empty. But of course the main implication arises in the case when F is good, A is good. If A is good, what is it that we have? For any object, the map from the group category to my category, the vertex algebraic category, that sends a form to the sum. one category, another. Is an equivalence of categories. So this is just a technical way of saying that this is like a torture, that any element is this. You can also see why I had to introduce the categorical language, because I can't say that any element is like this. What I'm saying is that any element is isomorphic to this one, and there is no canonical isomorphic. So this is really, you have to change your language. And informally speaking, all this categorical nonsense is a language to describe this situation, that if you fix, so to say, a reference point, then any other object is a result of adding a form, except that is a result means is equivalent to a vertex algebraic like this, and non-canonically, the space of isomorphisms is the space of certain types to forms, you see? Any questions? So, now that's the last kind of local, you see, this is all purely local, one last local observation. Remember, this was important for us even in the case of CP1. We needed to know how to divide by functions. And indeed, if we want to get any kind of shapes, then we need to be able to consider functions. Here is another observation. So here is my last local observation. So given a vertex algebraic, there is, and let me be informal, an obviously defined vertex algebraic A with F imperfect along with a vertex algebraic morphism. From A to yes, so at very little time, the reason for this is, if you go over the construction, you will see that all products are given by differential operators. And if you live in conformal degrees, weights 0 and 1, the worst it can get, you will have a differential operator of order 2, which arises when you compute the first product between two vector fields. Remember, what, for example, if you operations 1, 2, etc. of psi and a function, 2, 3, etc. will be 0. 1, 2, 3 will all be 0. The zeroth operation is a Lie-product. That, of course, is a differential operator of order 1. Everybody knows that. How do you compute the first bracket between vector fields? Well, for example, for simplicity, it's local. So you have a basis, di, dj. By adding a function, you can even make it be equal to 0. The point becomes compute the first product of two vector fields. For this, you either use Borchert's formula or the lambda bracket that Victor taught us. And you will see that essentially you will get a differential operator of order 2. This d hitting this f times plus minus this d hitting this g. If you think about the whole definition, you will see that inductively all operations will be like this. And therefore, it's not a problem to localize. This is a different approach to localizing. I started with, remember, Fagin's trick, which was extremely important for us at the beginning, because we started thinking in terms of fields. But then science, so to say, developed, and here is a perhaps more more refined explanation, just that in terms of operations, they are all differential operators, and hence localized. All right, so what does a... I still have a few minutes. Will you tolerate me a few minutes more? All right. So what does this all mean? Now, let's try doing this on the main floor. So suppose X... Algebraic, for the sake of definiteness, although what I have to say is always valid in any case.
Ah, for C infinity manifold?
Yeah, even then, although it's algebraic or analytic are more interesting cases, but not necessarily. Everything I said works always. So, look at the discussion of differential operators. That applies in any category as well.
And for the infinity function, it's always good, right? Because
you actually have coordinates. Well, yes, it's local, it's always good. But so, yeah, it's sort of main category. What I'm saying is that now we have, I'm even afraid to say this out loud, we have a sheaf of categories. We don't have any single object. And sometimes, as we will see, it cannot be there at all. But what we definitely have is a sheaf of categories. Of CDOs. In fact, of a groupoid, because all morphisms were used for this, are automatically isomorphic. So what do I mean by that? So I have a max. For any open set U, I can consider the category of, let's for simplicity look at vertex algebraic. If we have algebraic, then we do universal enveloping and we'll get CDO. Over the corresponding ring of functions there. Perhaps it's even better. I don't want to spend too much time on formalities. It really is doesn't belong to the scope of these lectures. I guess the better way to see it, to say it is, we have a category of a module such that restriction to any affine neighborhood will be like this, and an intersection they coincide. So something like this has to be. But we definitely have this. Furthermore, if U is small enough, or good, as I called it previously, then this thing is non-empty. A thing like that, I'm not going to give any kind of a definition, but just for those who have never heard such words and could never make out what they mean, what all of this means is referred to as a Jorde bound by the complex, the Durand, part of the Durand complex, consisting of those groups that have been used. So it's just this one sentence. This is, we have a Jorde bound by this complex. The meaning of this phrase is just as I said. We have, for each open set, we have a category such that its local description, as I explained, locally it's a torsor over three forms. So you have an object, you add a three form, close three form, you get another object, and all objects are obtained in this way, and the morphisms are given by two forms has described. That's all that's mean. So there's nothing really there. All right. So I guess it's. I wanted to tell you much more today, but that will have to be moved to Monday, I guess. So.
And then you explain how chain crosses.
Yeah. Would you like to me to speak with Loma? So you won't be here. I mean, I don't want to impose it on other people. I could spend another 15 minutes saying a little more, so that. But
okay, sorry.
Yes,
never mind. And so next time you construct abstraction.
Yes, and I'll try to look at the most important, or at least a remarkable example when X is a simple equal.
An abstraction will be chain classes.
CH2 of Taylor class.
The second chain. Ah, okay.
The second component of the chain class. C2 minus 1 half of C1 2. 2 minus 1 half of C1 2.